welcome you to the Russian travels of Pamela Travers with tonight's speaker, Olga Mayox. Olga is joining us from Moscow. She's just over here for a week, and she's going to be talking to us about this fantastic book, which has sold over 10,000 copies in Russia and been something of a phenomenon. It's a lost book, which she's going to tell us the story of, that she's then translated. And it's found this incredible readership in contemporary Russia. It's the very first book by the author of Mary Poppins, not a fairy tale, but a travelogue, Moscow Excursion, Moskovskaya Excursia. So Olga's going to speak for about 45 minutes before opening up to questions, so hopefully we'll have an hour together. So please welcome Olga Mayox.
Thank you very much for coming, and I just want to show you the book. I'm a librarian and I'm also a translator. And usually when you translate books, it takes you half an hour, half a year maybe, it depends. But this book took me minimum 6 years to prepare.
Wow.
And I think it was 10 years ago as I learned that it exists. When just once looking through the bibliography of Pamela Travers, I noticed suddenly that the first book mentioned was not Mary Poppins, everybody knows, but the book named Moscow Excursion. And it seemed strange to me, I knew nothing about. I knew that she was interested in Russian culture and Russian philosophy and Russian ballet, but I didn't know what kind of book that was. And when I was once have some time in between different translations, I thought that maybe I should look at this book. And then I realized that there is no any copy in any library in Soviet, in Russia. And I had to order it from abroad and start reading and realized that maybe I have just spent money for nothing, because this book probably will be never accepted in Russia because it is too critical towards my motherland, and the Russian public is very sensitive to the things which are written about our country. But still it was the truth, and I know that. And that is the problem for a translator, how to introduce a book to a reader. Because you need not only to translate word by word, but make this bridge. And I decided that I should anyhow start to making this bridge. But before starting a bridge, I need to have at least a Russian version for myself. And that was the first problem, because the book is written very vividly, and this Russian edition, you see, is also with a lot of photographs describing the time. But the text is all the names, all the personal names in the book are omitted, and it's difficult to say who was these people Pamela met in Russia. And she herself wrote that it is perhaps necessary to stress the fact that the characters in the book are all symbolized personages, and that I have studiously given fictitious initials for the names throughout. So that should anyone slipping among the paragraphs imagine that has come face to face with himself, I take this opportunity of cautiously assuring him that he is mistaken. It is always someone else. Pamela Travers came to Russia in 1932 in autumn, and the book appeared, was published in 1934. And that is a rare picture of her as a young person, as she was at that time. And the first thing was the reason why did she come to Russia, and it was the first publication in the periodical in 1933, I think it was. And the first question I had is, what was the reason for going to Soviet Union? It seems to be a very strange choice. And the more difficult it was because she was ill the year before, she had a tuberculosis, and she was even prohibited to go to London and had to stay in the country. And the moment she was cured, she undertook this trip. But because you have no names, it's difficult to translate. And you, even when you translate word to word, you can introduce some false meanings. And some details seem from the very beginning rather ridiculous. And some scraps of information were very puzzling. And so I tried to check what was written. And one of the first things that appeared to be, first of all, I think that she was just making a caricature, that she was just laughing and just enjoying herself because it was just a kind of a parody change from when you start reading. But then, when I start translating, I had to stop many times and to try to guess what did she mean. For example, one of the first stops was during their trip to Leningrad. They were going by ship, and on this ship, the propaganda has started. And they were given different books, the tourists, because she was traveling in a group of British tourists, mostly trade union members. And she describes different, the book is full of different small details, which seems random, but through my work, it appeared to be that all the, even the smallest details appear to be actual, real. Thus, she has seen the film, and she described it only by one sentence. That was the sentence about the description of the last scene of the film she liked. When the dark waters of Neva engulf successfully an armchair, a gramophone, and a bottle of beer, probably the true bourgeois symbols, I just decided that I probably could find out what was the film she has seen. And I turned to a friend of mine, a famous film historian, Natalia Nusinova, and asked her, maybe she could just guess what it was, just by these three, by this small. And she, luckily, she said, yes, it should be probably the film Adventures of Ekaterina, and that was really a very eccentric comedy, and the first work by two famous Soviet film directors, cousins of Trauberg. And then she wrote a fantastic thing, she said. But it was, this film was ruined during the war. All the copies were preserved in Tsarskoye Selo near Leningrad. And there was a fire when Nazis came into the city, into the town. And we can't see this film. And so this is a real description, and Travers has seen it. And so I understood that each small detail has some roots in real life. And so the work started. That is her attitude to the of a normal tourist coming to Soviet Union, just to see with their real eyes and to realize what was going on. And of course, there were predecessors. And in the book, I could trace real parallels between experience and the attitude Travers has and the descriptions she probably have read, because just on a year before, George Bernard Shaw was in the Soviet Union, and it was and he wrote a lot about his trip, you probably know, and he was fascinated by what the thing he has seen, and especially he was, he said that considered Gulag to be a very fascinating enterprise, and said that from what I gather, they can stay there as long as they like in the concentration camps. And leaving this land of hope and returning to the Western countries of despair, that was how he characterized his visit to the Soviet Union. He met Stalin, and he was very positive about the things he has seen. But Travers see absolutely different picture, and what is interesting, she, being just a young lady, writing about critical articles at that time about theater, and writing poetry of her own, she came to Soviet Union well prepared. She has addresses of some people, telephone numbers, and she had a program of her own. She tried to realize, in spite of the program that was suggested by interest. And the first person she met in Leningrad was some person who she called T, just the first letter, initial. And she says that, "I have met T. He came to the hotel last night and took me and my pound of loaf sugar and three of the lemons." That was how you have to, the travelers took with themselves to be on the safe side in Russia. To see that, you remember him at Cambridge. He shares the room with T. In some of the biographies it was mentioned, just a scrap of information, that probably she was acquainted, it was a hint, not so much proved at that time, with Hubert Butler. Who was Hubert Butler? It was Irish essayist, journalist, an adventurous person, first of all, who in 1920s, 1930s traveled around Europe and the world, independent. It was called later, here you see in the book that was published when he was in his 80s, Independent Spirit. That was very important. Most of the people of Pamela was attracted to were independent spirits, independent minds. And in 1930s, just at that time, he really was in Leningrad, because he was studying Russian. He was interested also in the situation in the country. And he lived with his acquaintance, and he was a member of a so-called teaching brigade. There were people who learned, who knew English and teach it in the institute as a brigade and to private persons. And so Hubert Butler was among them, and he they were acquainted with Pamela Travers, probably. And Hubert Butler wrote a novel about his stay in Leningrad at that time that is called Peter's Window. And here he gives some evidence about what the house was like and what the life was like. And his description has similarities with the description Pamela Travers produced, just also the scraps of them. And he also names people he was staying and got acquainted in Leningrad. So the first person, this was Zed. Who was this man? And he names him. He says that it was, by the way, it was Hubert Butler who made the best translation of The Cherry Orchard by Chekhov, and it was staged in London in 1934. And also an interesting thing, his books appeared only when he was already retired, pretty late, but suddenly I realized that this very book was translated into French, and introduction to this book was written by our famous poet Joseph Brodsky. So all the lines are all the time united in different ways. And so the host was someone called Zed. And in his novel, Hubert Butler told that he was living with Arkhangelsky and wrote and presented this person. Nikolai's father was a priest in Tiflis, and they have fled from Bolsheviks to Crimea for a short time in white hands. When the Bolsheviks seized Crimea, Nikolai was sent to England and became one of the most brilliant Debord pupils, that was a philosopher in Reading University. It was there that later he married Connie, a fellow student, and influenced by left-wing intellectualism of time, became communist and decided to join his widowed mother in Leningrad. So it's really, I knew almost nothing about that period and the relations, cultural relations between Britain and Soviet Union at that time. Because in Russia we had no information about it. And here in Great Britain also it was not so much studied, so it was difficult to find any kind of evidence. And then suddenly that puzzle became to get together. And I tried to find out who was this Arkhangelsky, who was that. But no, there was no evidence about him, though I know his name and his family name and first name, and no evidence about this teaching brigade or anything. Then suddenly I realized that we have a very important list of names of the victims of the Stalin regime made by Society Memorial. And here you can find practically everyone. There are thousands and millions of people. And here I have found Arkhangelsky. He was persecuted in 1937. And there was the address. The address of the house described in Pamela Travers' book. And so you can see the picture. That is the house. And Herbert Butler wrote, "A large block of bourgeois flats near Ekaterinburgsky Sad, the Catherine Gardens. The lift had not worked since 1917, and sat in a well of the staircase, full of tram tickets and old newspapers. The apartment on the fifth floor really exists now. I have been there last May. The house was renovated or even restored. And on the fifth floor there is now a small hotel, so any one of you can book a room and stay there. And even this lift still exists.
Is it working though?
Yes, it is. No, it's a beautiful place, really. It appears. And there were some people coming, and just to describe how difficult the work was, this investigation. Again, there is just one sentence. When Travers came to this flat, and she's very glad that she met people and she's welcomed, and because after all this hostile customers and people and tourists, she just is in a friendly atmosphere, and she wrote just one sentence. A young poet came in and read a long poem in Russian about Aspasia. It sounded good. Nothing more. And I tried, who could it be? It's impossible to, is it possible to find out? I asked many poets from Leningrad, my acquaintance, if anyone knows anything about such a poem about Aspas. Nobody knew. But in Hubert Butler's novel, he mentions two names. It was Igunov and Lihachov. And Igunov, or Andrei Nikolov, it is his literary name, really was a poet, and also this he has also studied classical literature, and probably he could write this poem about Aspasia. But also again, the fate of this man was a tragedy. He was persecuted on the next year, in 1933, and had no permission to return to Leningrad. And after the war, because he was at the American side, he was again persecuted and returned to Leningrad only in late 50s. But he was a brilliant and outstanding scholar. And I understand that Hubert Butler even invited him to come to Great Britain because he could realize how important his work was. And he worked for the rest of his life in the house, in Pushkin House in Leningrad, and was a well-known scholar, but all the time kept himself in the shade, and had no family and no publications. Most of his young works have vanished forever. His first book was published after his death in Austria. And now the scraps of his work are collected and studied. And he really was acquainted with people in the surrounding of Daniel Harms, for example, and Mandelstam. And so Pamela Travers came very much near to these circles. That's funny episode because they were suggested to make a trip, private trip, and went not to the pond but to the cemetery. And it's famous, how it is called? Famous Alexander Nevsky Cemetery. But at that time they were organized a special Soviet section. And she described it, and you can even now you can find these monuments. But this is an engine driver, and traction engine still exists. Because you, when you read the description of such a monument, you think that it is just humiliation. And when you find a photograph, a picture, you understand that it's, the reality is. It's just as she has described it. And then they moved to Moscow. And on their way there, on the train, they met several soldiers. And it's interesting that they started a communication with English tourists. And when they learned that there is still a king in Great Britain, they were so much surprised that they said, why haven't you killed him? And that was one of the reasons. For example, this Pamela Travers was accused to writing a caricature. I have found an article, the only critical review of this book, which was published in the United States. And the critic wrote, could you ever believe in such a conversation? Could anyone suggest to kill the British king? Unfortunately, we knew that it was a plan. And a very important and interesting episode also about the film. When in Moscow, Pamela Travers start looking for some visits. And it's also a mystery because she didn't know Russian and there were not so many people who knew just the scraps of English at the time. And it was not very, it was rather dangerous to show that you could speak foreign languages because it was, it will show out that you are a bourgeois personality. But she says that she is going, that's what she writes. You were quite right to give me the letter to the cinema studio. It has enabled me to have my senses beaten black and blue, if such a thing is possible. The thing is, the whole book is written as a series of letters she is writing to some unknown person, that I don't know the address, who is left in Britain. And so she went to some studio and met a director, the most extraordinary young man from Birmingham, who has gone so bolshevik that even the Bolsheviks think him rather too much on the red side and are trying to cool him down. And that young man showed her a film about Magnitogorsk. He is contributing to this work himself. The film swarms with young Russians, Komsomols is the word, all apparently with utmost venom, trying to door the next person out of job in order that he or she may do it himself. Could we guess what was the film? Really, at that time there was one film made by a very famous Netherlands film director, Joris Evans, who came to Russia and made this film on Magnitogorsk. But they had an international crew and they lived in barracks themselves and they were witnesses of what was going on this construction site. For example, at Magnitogorsk there were 35,000 political prisoners working as slaves and among them there were 5,000 small children who died during this construction. But no one from this group noticed that, and they considered it to be just a normal situation because they were class enemies. Travers described with horror the dialogue with this British Bolshevik. It was fantastic. There was a kulak, class enemy, wrote the director, and blew a fanfare. The Komsomols, judging by the energy they put into playing in the bell, the Komsomols were up to all class enemy dodgers. They posed only to kill a few class enemy babies. The cries of these echoed in the siren, and then got to work on the class enemy himself with maximum of noise. Travers was horrified with the things she has seen, and she wrote that she was bruised. And when leaving the film studio, she was left alone waiting for the train, to wait for the tram, and because the studio was on the outskirts of the city, and she describes her feelings. I kept hearing the director's voice like a knell, barrels of lead, freedom of sexes, primal woman, barrels of lead, freedom. Could you without much bother send me a nice comfortable pair of shackles? There were some episodes from this film. It also had a peculiar fate because it was shown in Europe, but it was not shown at that time in Soviet Union. There were many reasons it was considered to be suspicious. And it was firstly shown in Soviet Union in 1960s. But still it is now on YouTube and you can also see it. Very impressive, really. But who was this young man? Really, at this film crew, there was one Englishman, and his name was Herbert Marshall. He was very young at the time, and he was a disciple of Sergei Eisenstein. Probably was the one who Pamela Travers met, and whom she wanted, she was recommended to meet when she was in Moscow. Herbert Marshall is well known also as a film and theater director. He was once a director for Old Week, for example, and he was also a very good translator and have translated many contemporary Soviet poetry into English. He was one of the founders of this Soviet-British Society for Cultural Relations and very active in this field. And finally, after the Second World War, they moved with his wife. She was an actress. There are some translations from the war period. They moved to, she was an actress and sculptor. They moved to United States, and there he left a very interesting archive full of his tape records of interview with famous Soviet literary men, writers and poets, as well as some lectures by Eisenstein. So it's, the archive is in one of the university libraries in South Illinois. Still not fully investigated. And one more episode is maybe among dozens of episodes this book is full, is made of. For example, it is maybe one of the most striking. It is her visit to the theater in Moscow. It became gradually, I realized what was the reason why she has come to Russia. She was not so much interested in politics, and though she had a very thorough attitude and very independent view on the situation. Not maybe so much independent, but still she definitely has discussed it with different people and read a lot. There was a lot of writings about Soviet Union at that time. She was rather skeptical, but the one thing she was very much interested, as maybe many of the intellectuals who had come to Russia at that time, she was interested in avant-garde art, in all this novelty. And she was looking for any possibility to see that. And at that time, it was absolutely out of the tourist program. They were taken to the Bolshoi Theater and they saw the Swan's Lake. And she was, being a ballet dancer, in her use herself. She was very much disappointed because the technique was fantastic and music was fantastic, but she wanted to see something new. And then, of some miracle, she said that I meet another director, the second director. I talked to some person, and he promised her to give her a ticket to a theater performance, and that's supposed to be Hamlet. And then she describes in very particular details this performance. But before I'll tell you about it, it's difficult. It's now we can have several Hamlets in one city at a time. But at that time, it was the only one that became, that what I have learned myself, because the Soviet government was rather suspicious about Shakespeare on a whole. And Hamlet was particular suspicious, especially for Stalin, because of this idea of this rivalry for the crown. And the only possibility to stage Hamlet was to turn it into a comedy, really. And that's what had happened with Hamlet in 1932 in Vakhtangov Theatre in Moscow. And that was a performance made by famous director Akimov, who said that it shall be a comedy. I can't help it, because there was no other way to perform it. And he ordered even to rewrite this classical text. And it appeared to be the comedy full of eccentric, shocking tricks, buffoonery, comic chases, and etc. But first of all, there is a lot of questions. Who told, how did Travers learn about this performance? Who told her? Who has invited her? Probably it could be Hubert Butler or Herbert Marshall also. But maybe she had already read about that when she was in Great Britain, because the first night was on the 19th of May, 1932, and already in June there were first reviews in Observer and Manchester Guardian. So probably she was interested on her own, but how she did communicate, I don't know. Because she traveled through Moscow. Firstly, she came to a wrong theater, realized that it was a wrong play, and then she describes how she ran across Moscow crying Hamlet, and all people like in a ballet showed her the direction. And it's also how she could describe it. It's really worth reading. I advise you very much. And Nikolai Akimov, so he was, had to, the main goal was to deprive the comedy from all the classical burden. And it should be an optimistical Hamlet, cheerful Hamlet. And at this, our aim was, first of all, to present optimistic, cheerful, and joyous Hamlet, which has gained a bad reputation as a gloomy, mystic, symbolistic, and reactional philosophical play, wrote Akimov. The scandalous performance was a great success. There were people were eager to see it, it is interesting how Pamela Travers describes the performance. For example, Ophelia had no any signs of being in love with Hamlet, and she also is presented as a drunkard person, and she drowned because she was absolutely drunk. To be or not to be, this famous dialogue is presented as a scene in a tavern where Horatio and Hamlet are just stammering it to each other, and the dialogue is divided between them. So Hamlet is not alone in this. And could you imagine that what was Pamela Travers' reaction to all this humiliation? What a play! It would have broken professors' hearts, but mine felt like a heart for the first time since I have been in Russia. Every possible rule was broken. The text was murderously cut about, and great words of Erasmus and anonymous buffoonery interpolated. The characters too were altered. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern became a couple of clowns who were let loose before a drop curtain every time a scene needed to be changed. But when you come to think of it, these two are rather vaudeville and are easily turned into a slapstick comedians. Pamela Travers has also paid the tribute, we can't see the comedy anymore, but there are just some drawings for the costumes. The striking thing is that it really was probably a fantastic performance, because the music to the performance has been made by Dmitri Shostakovich, and it's again just like with the film Adventures of Oksimbrina. You can imagine this sense of useful joy and creativity they incorporated in their work. And I was making a presentation about the book last year in Italy and was looking for this photo of Shostakovich. It's the only one where he is smiling. You can find no more, because it was just on the eve, the 1932 was the year when the politics towards art and literature has absolutely changed in Soviet Union, and all experiments were strictly prohibited. And so it was just on the eve of this tragedy, their private tragedy, and they enjoyed themselves at that moment to the utmost degree. So, Shostakovich worked in a tune with the director, and for example, Ophelia sang songs in the style of German cabaret girl singers from the beginning of our century, accompanied by the hot and spicy jazz melodies. That is the evidence of Pamela Travers. So, if looking for the new art, Pamela Travers has positively found it in the theater and was very happy with that. The brand new Hamlet she witnesses was a great success, but the fate of the performance was a tragedy, though the performance itself appeared to be a comedy. When the government political line has changed, the performance, this King of Hamlet was prohibited, and they were only allowed in the late 1932 to show it for several times in Leningrad. And Akimov has a chance to present his performance in Leningrad. And at that time it was a rule, and every person who was accused of being not a social realist, so to say, had to talk to the audience and accept his faults. And so I'll read you just a part from the speech Akimov has made before the performance in Leningrad. It has got the most severe reaction from the Soviet critics. Of course, this evaluation is absolutely fair. Beyond any doubt, comrades, my Hamlet is a very bad performance. I totally agree with the option of the Soviet critics, but I wish to attract your attention, comrades, to just one moment. Of course, it is a moment of minor importance in the performance. I could say even the one of no particular significance. The undying tragedy about Hamlet, the Prince of Denmark, has been performed by all theaters of the world and on the best Russian stages. All these Hamlets were, of course, much better than mine. But to be honest, comrades, there were no Hamlet in the world, never and nowhere, where the audience could help to avoid the feeling of a painful boredom. But, dear comrades, the one thing, let me promise to you, you'll not be bored today. I guarantee that. And Travers witnessed the audience was not bored. She described the enthusiasm of the public. She is fascinated by people's empathy. Her notes prove that the performance, in spite of all transformations of the classical version, was accepted with a delight. Having found an avant-garde she was looking for in Russia, Travers protected it from criticism from any sort. Thus, when visiting the British Embassy, she argued with English diplomats and expressed their indignation. Pamela Travers' verdict is absolutely positive. Not Hamlet, perhaps, but Hamlet enough for me. And I can't help feeling that Shakespeare would have preferred it to hybrid productions that can get a new kick out of Hamlet only by putting him into plus fours or those other horrors where Hamlet is only a peg to hang the scenery on. The book is written in a vivid and rich style and is balancing on the edge of eccentricity typical for the epoch. One can't help thinking that probably, if given a chance, Travers would suit very well in the company of young experimenters and innovators who played a leading role in the Soviet art of that time. The avant-garde theater performance has become for Travers the highlight of her trip to Russia and the most human event. Being very critical in her attitude to Soviet reality, she considers the theater to be the only place where the Russians become a collection of liberated humans, human beings, instead of functioning as members of groups, cells, Soviets. Travers is sure that all tourists properly to understand Russia must be taken to the theater immediately on arrival. Clichés, fortresses, that's a part of the program. Nonsense, the life of the country is here. The book by Pamela Travers and Hamlet by Nikolai Akimov have been for a long time doomed to the oblivion. But nowadays, the interest to avant-garde art is growing. The world is once again fascinated by this unique experiment. In 2014, London Symphony Orchestra have included suite Hamlet by Dmitri Shostakovich in the early Opus 32, because in 1950s, he wrote a new version for the famous film Hamlet, and it's just absolutely different music piece. Once again, the music, provocative, vivid, original, and ever young, impressed the audience, which could not help to compare the fate of the disgraced by Soviet state composer and the young Danish prince. Perhaps reimaginings of Shakespeare do not simply reflect the culture that hosts them, wrote English critic at that time, but the lives and experiences of those who do the reimagining. Shostakovich's score for Hamlet demonstrated that the bard's genius can indeed be augmented and make us all look upon familiar material with fresh eyes. And I think that Pamela Travers, no doubt, would be happy to be present at the concert. So that's really the end of my presentation. I just want to tell you that the book seems to be rather thick one because nearly half of it is my commentary and description of all the places, nearly all places and persons whom she has visited. And really, my desire is, of course, to return this episode, important episode in the biography of Pamela Travers, to British audience too. Maybe someday it will be published and with commentaries, mine or somebody else. But anyhow, it's very interesting and very vivid description of the time we know not so much about. Thank you.
know about the everyday life that she would have experienced? What sort of things she would eat, or whether she would go shopping?
Well, it's very funny because she described that they were placed in the hotels with a lot of difficulties, and there was not sufficient food, and the menu was rather limited, but she didn't say that they were starving, and they didn't want to show that, because mostly all the others were very pro-Sovietic, and they were, of course, it was very difficult for them, and they didn't want to show that, and they didn't complain. She said that she was advised to bring, for example, sugar and lemons, and that's also the interesting thing, because I couldn't believe that it is so important with all these lemons, because the final scene is how she went to meet some Russian writer. I have some suggestions who that could be, but it's difficult to tell for sure. He learned that she has lemons, he cries and ordered a car to go to the hotel and to fetch these lemons. And again, in this, for example, American review, it was said as a second proof that it is just an impossible caricature. It's impossible to imagine that the Russian writer of a high level could be interested in lemons. Either he is not the writer of this level, or so in any way she is lying. And she describes how she went to Kolkhoz, and there she met some children who were begging something from her. And she describes the long lines, because definitely it was 1932 and there were still problems with food supply. It was when this new economical situation was stopped for several years, and really Stalin's economical politics was really not so successful. And at that very time, for example, Shaw wrote that there is plenty of eating, no problem with anything, and you are not supposed to pay for anything, and do come every month and live there. And most of the books written at that time by those people who were very hopeful that this social experiment, unfortunately not unique, but merely half worldwide, will be a success. They did believe that maybe it is a way out for the world, and they wanted to see what they were expecting to see, and that's how it happened.
Yes. I was just wondering how much tourism there was in the early 1930s. Were there companies already in London and Moscow doing exchange trips?
In Moscow, there was Interest, the only company through all the Soviet times. And they functioned, and they have offices here in London. And it was a part of foreign policy and propaganda, just to bring as many tourists as possible to Soviet Russia to see this successful experiment. And I didn't know that there were really so many people traveling. I also suspected, thought that it was just a few coming. And this time I have studied especially because I'm just investigating what is now how Soviet Union was presented to British children at that time, and read some children's books about that period, English children's books. And I realized that there were a lot of people coming to Soviet Union from Great Britain and from Europe, and they were, many of them wrote memoirs, and usually they were just either absolutely positive or absolutely negative. The most difficult thing was to present a real situation. And Travers tried to do this in a way. And she is saying from once she is considering the situation, comparing with fascism, and we see that she is really thinking about, she is interested in understanding. And these books, the same as for example, Arthur Ransom's book, they were not so popular. People wanted to have this just either positive or either negative attitude and don't want all these compromises and complex situations, views, yes.
I was just wondering whether, presumably Mary Poppins came later.
Yes.
And did any of this Russian trip find its way, do you think, into Mary Poppins anywhere at all?
Look, maybe we can find this independent spirit, of course, and her own attitude to everything. She, and of course, she, we can have this feeling that she masters her material very well. Describe it differently, even from the quotations I have read to you. So it's interesting to read what she has read in her first book. She has a sharp pen.
Is it popular, Mary Poppins, in Russia?
Yes, it is tremendously popular, and it was very well translated and even a kind of retold, so to say, because it was made absolutely Russian. I have read that Pamela Travers was interested how it was translated, and she had a copy of Russian book in her library. Though she, I suppose, had never been paid for that.
It was actually obligatory at some point to read it at schools.
Yes.
Yes, it was part of the education program.
And the film was shot.
Well, it's not exactly, but let us say, the motives from Pamela Travers. So it was very popular, it was hugely popular.
Yes. Did she travel around, you said she went on this boat with trade unionists?
She names them. First professors, there were three professors, trade unions, workers, as she names them, and some collective farm people too. So she was the only writer or poet or anything.
But she had contacts. You say she had addresses and phone numbers?
Yes, yes. She came with that. So she probably was interested in the Soviet situation before.
Yeah.
And there were a lot of lectures. Sergei Eisenstein was, because it was my main question, what was the reason for her trip? Because she has traveled, for example, to France or to Spain before that. I think the interest was great at that time. And many people, because it was after the First World War, and the world was seeking a new way, was looking for innovation, for new ideas. And the Soviet experience, as it was presented by the left-wing newspapers and people, it was very attractive. And everyone wanted to see for themselves. And I suppose it was not so expensive to travel. Though she was, at that time, Pamela said that the program in Russia was very strictly organized. They were promised to go to Nizhny Novgorod, but they were not allowed, probably because it was hung at that time and they didn't want to show that to her. But at the same time, people, Hubert Butler lived on his own teaching in Leningrad and then returning back. There were people who traveled on their own, and people who, there are different situations. It was not just a closed boundary as I have imagined myself. And there was a lot made as a part of foreign policy, but it was also a private interest, and a lot of just private persons did travel, it was interesting. And also writers, of course, and artists, they were invited, and they were considered to be, they had to present a positive image of Soviet Union. It was very important to get contracts, to get support in this industrial construction, and everything.
Yes, please. How do you account for the popularity of your book? Is it about because of Travers, or is it the 30s, or is it a combination?
Of course, Pamela Travers herself is a celebrity, mm-hmm. And it was interesting for everyone to know that. And of course I was very nervous because of that, because I thought that this criticism that was in her book would be would disappoint the reader, so to say, put it mildly. But the thing is, when I realized her real interest and this desire to find the real essence of something positive, that was very important. And maybe even my commentary helped in a way to realize what is going on and what was going on and how she, because really it's unimaginable how she found all these people, because for example this film studio, it's on the far outskirts, it's Gorky film studio near in the south, northwest of Moscow. So even now you have to travel by metro and then by the same tram she had traveled, and on her own. And there is, and the same with the theater. And then she went to see this writer, dramatist, also. How they did communicate, who gave her, it was, it seems from the very beginning that she had just a pocket full of some letters for different people she wished to. She got prepared, she definitely knew that she will not be allowed. She describes how KGB follows them, she was not allowed. She tried to call Hubert Butler, and she all the time was told that no connection, no telephone, no possibility to call him. And then she realized that it was possible. Also, by the help of lemons, she was. But she went to Moscow and tried to leave, to call Leningrad. In Moscow, she was told at the hotel, no connection at all. And well, then she said, well, I'll give you lemons, but you should connect me. And they. And it was interesting for me because, for example, for this playwright, I had a special timetable. A special table with different names of all the playwrights on the list. And I knew, for example, Afinagenov's daughter, and I asked her, Ivanov's son, who was a famous scholar, and I asked them, because I need a person who knew English and who could communicate. And there was about this writer, that the only thing was that his wife was Natalia, and none of them had the wife with this name. And I said, maybe the first time in her book she says something, she just forgot what was the name, and Natasha is just a typical Russian name for many foreigners. And then suddenly, just on the eve of my going to London, I read something about Lunacharsky, and Lunacharsky had the wife named Natasha. Natalia Razine, and they had a flat with two rooms on the first level, but there were five rooms above. Anyhow, I don't know, but it's still interesting. It's interesting, and it tells so much about, not only about Pamela Travers, but about us all, about this episode, I think totally covered by the Second World War. We just forgot about that, and then there was a long period of hostility and all this propaganda, and that was something good, people to people, for both countries, for both cultures.
To find information of reality from the early 1930s, from that period, because of the way that history has been treated since then. I mean, is this just one quirky way of doing it, or is it really a very important way of recapturing that history, because there aren't really many options? Is it difficult? All right, basically, it is quite difficult.
And the reason was not because the archives exist, and a lot of memoirs were preserved, maybe and are published and are very popular. But the thing was, I personally realized from the history of my family, that people did not tell family history. It was dangerous. They never tell to their children who were their parents, grandparents, and so on. In all, nearly all the families, or just some limited information. The less you knew, the safer you were. And it was just common law. for everyone. And that's why now there are so many people who are interested in their family history, and they start asking, but sometimes it's too late to learn something. And we are very much interested in family history. We have social history, the history of the country, but we very often don't know anything about our grandparents. For example, when I started, for me it was very important work because I also found a lot about the times the thing was we have never asked questions. That was the most difficult thing. I never thought that I should ask my mother what she was reading at her, when she was a girl, for example. She told me something. I never talked to my grandmother about the wartime when she was in Leningrad during the siege. And she never told about it. But we tried to be careful to her and not to make anything harmful, but anyhow, people who came from France from during the Second World War, they never told the truth about this dreadful situations and these horrors they were witness to. For example, I just realized suddenly my grandfather was a commissar, and I knew from my parents that he was one of the young men who said that he was older than he was to enter the army. And I always considered it to be the Civil War. And only 2 years ago, I looked at the monument at the cemetery and realized that it was the First World War. The First World War in Russia was absolutely forgotten. It was covered by the revolution and everything. And we just now start to open it once again. So thank you to Pamela Travers for also this possibility to ask questions. That is a very important thing. You start asking questions. And all the time, as a rule, I was asking questions because she came to a palace in Tsarskoye Selo and she wrote, for example, it was this is the cabinet of the last Tsar. He was an unfortunate person, and I know why, because he has collected horseshoe, and all the horseshoe were placed in the wrong direction. Maybe. I can't just translate it because nobody will believe it, and they will decide that she was absolutely crazy. I need some remark to be done, because I had to protect Travers. I wrote a letter to the director of the museum, and told her, and because Pamela Travers is very popular in Russia, I got immediately the answer, and they checked the books, and said, yes, we have checked. In 1930, it was not this cabinet, but not on the writing table, but on the side tables there was, named all the horseshoes that were according to the memoirs from 1930, sorry. Again, once again and again, always do ask the questions. Still there are some personalities that I can't find, but it was just a year. I was very happy when I found about this poet, for example, who can say about this has passed, and that suddenly came. And he had a very difficult life story because he was not allowed to leave before the war. He was not allowed to return to Leningrad. He lived in Novgorod. And when Germans had come there, he was considered later on to be a collaborator. And we never asked questions, for example. We don't know how did people live on the occupied territory. Because they had to earn living, they had to have some job places. Nobody investigated it. Nobody ever talked. Because still, even now, when we have a special kind of list, you have to answer some questions when you you apply for the work. And it still remains the same from the Soviet times. And this list, there was the questions, were any of your relatives on the occupied territory? And it still exists. And if they were, well, in 1960s it was not so dangerous, but in 1950s it was definitely that you will never get a job. And you will be suspected and you can be accused of anything. And so he, when this boy, when he was also believing that maybe Germans, such a cultivated, such a cultural nation, will be liberators. There were many people who were thinking so, but we just didn't know. Maybe Anna Akhmatova also thought so, because the situation was so disastrous. So they just was looking for any possibility to be saved. We should.
Our children are beginning to, I mean, our young people are now better at asking questions about the past, or is it still really a reluctance?
They think of the history in a different way, because I'm the leader of a children, head of a children's book department, and I do communicate with children. We talk about history, and we try to find different approaches to collect family history, to make books about family history, and some new books, children's book appear just about this information, and family memoirs are written. But when last week I was to an exhibition, you know that here in the Royal Art Academy there is a very good exhibition of Russian avant-garde art. And in Moscow we had an exhibition on children's books. They are fascinating, children's books from the 1920s. They were just a unique experience. And they gave birth, for example, to Penguin books, if you don't know. When I was looking at all these books, there was a small children has come from school class, about 8-9 years old. And the guide, an elderly lady, told them, "Children, do you know who are pioneers?" Nobody knew. Nobody could answer. The elderly boy said, "The pioneers are those who are going everywhere first. So explorers and so on." She tried to explain to them something about scouts or something of that kind. And then I was returning to my job on a tram, and some children with grandparents, parents were on a tram, and there was an announcement. There is a factory named after Ilyich. And I heard a young voice cry, "Mother, who is this Ilyich?" So it's difficult to say, but they knew some other history. And maybe it is a kind of liberating, because their feelings would not be so much hurt as maybe of their grandparents, and they realize the truth.